好，我们今天的第二场的讨论现在开始。那我们下午有四，我们本场有四位这个报告人，我把这个顺序报告一下。第一位是来自尼赫鲁大学的 Nivedita Menon 教授，是政治学的教授。等。第二位是来自中国社会科学院的张志强教授。对，第三位是来自印度理工大学的所罗门·本杰明教授。第四位是来自首都师范大学的江梅教授。好，那我们下午还是每位讲者还是30分钟啊，好，那么可以放一下。
Hello, okay, we'll begin the afternoon session now. We'll have 4 speakers lined up in the afternoon. The first one will be Professor Nivedita Menon.Followed by Professor Zhang Zhiqiang, and then next will be Professor Solomon Benjamin, and to be followed by Professor Jiang Mei from Beijing. Each one of you will have 30 minutes, including translation for presentation. Thank you.
我本人是来自中国广州中山大学的吴重庆。
My name is Wu Chongqing from Guangzhou Sun Yat-sen University.
好，那我们下面有请第一位发言。是 Nivedita Menon 教授，她是尼赫鲁大学的政治学教授，也是非常重要的女性主义学者。
Well, next we'll have Professor Menon to speak. She's from Nehru University. He's a political scientist and also a very important feminist. Let's welcome her.
This has been an extraordinary morning. The kinds of translations that have been enabled by our very talented translators here is one level of translation, but the other level of translation has been conceptually and in conversations, and it's been a very exciting morning.
我们有了一个非常令人兴奋而美好的早上，那有一个非常好的翻译在帮助我们的沟通。
In this presentation, I'm going to present a very new work, which I'm just beginning, in which I'm trying to do with psychoanalysis what has been done for Marxism in our parts of the world for a very long time, which is to say, ask two questions. What is being done under the name of psychoanalysis?And what are the other practices that are followed by psychoanalysts which may not fit into traditional psychoanalysis discourse?
接下来我想要报告的是我的最新的研究工作，那是跟精神分析有关，特别是精神分析跟马克思主义在印度。那我将会处理两个层次的问题，第一个是精神分析已经做了什么？第二个呢，是有哪一些其他的实践跟它没有办法被精神分析容纳在里面的其他的实践。
I have a written text which is actually there in the Book of Abstracts. I will simply read it, and I will stop after each paragraph for translation.
Yeah.我将会念朗诵我的稿子，那我会停下来，然后让翻译发生。对。
It has seemed to many scholars that Freudian psychoanalysis universalizes a human condition, universalizes as a human condition, what is essentially a narrowly parochial experience, that of male European modernity. Fatima Mernissi comparing Imam Ghazali and Sigmund Freud on female sexuality shows that while Ghazali, writing in Persia in the 11th century, believed he was attempting to reveal the true Muslim belief on the subject, Freud, at the triumphant inception of modernity in Europe, could claim the authority of science to elaborate not just a theory of European sexuality, but a universal explanation of the human female. Mernissi argues that in comparing Freud's and Ghazali's theory, we are in fact comparing the two cultures' different conceptions of sexuality, the former assuming female sexuality to be passive, the latter to be active, but with both of them seeing women or woman as destructive to the social order for these entirely opposite reasons.
在许多学者看来，弗洛伊德式的精神分析将那些原本属于地方性的狭义经验，将其普遍化视为人类总体的境况，而且是男人人类总体的境况。Fatima Mernissi 比较了Emma Ghazali 与弗洛伊德在女性性欲特质的学说之后，表示 Ghazali 在十一世纪以波斯语写作的时候，认为他所企图探究的是穆斯林在主体上的真正信念。而弗洛伊德在欧洲正当现代性顺利的启动时，宣称科学的权威不仅能阐述欧洲性欲特质的理论，更能提出关于全人类女性放诸四海皆准的解释。Mernissi 主张，当比较弗洛伊德与 Ghazali 的理论，我们实际上比较的是两种不同文化对性欲特质所进行的不同的理解与不同的概念化的方式。前者假设女性性欲特质是被动的，而后者则假设为主动。然而当他们分别将女性视为对社会秩序是解构破坏的时候，他们所抱持的是完全相反的理由。
Indian psychoanalysts have long struggled with what they saw as the difference between Indian and Western patients when it comes to becoming proper masculine subjects. Girindra Shekhar Bose, who founded the Indian Psychoanalytical Society in 1921, wrote to Freud, I quote him, "My Indian patients do not exhibit castration symptoms to such a marked degree as my European cases. The desire to be a female is more easily unearthed in Indian male patients than in European. The Oedipus mother is very often a combined parental image, and this is a fact of great importance," unquote. He wrote this to Freud, and Freud replies blandly. He promises to keep in mind the difference mentioned by Bose, but warns him against arriving at any hasty conclusions.
印度的精神分析师很早就发现，有文化差，对，很早就对文化差异的问题感到非常的棘手。他们在自己的病人身上看见，当他们在转变正式的成为一个雄性主体的时候，他在病人身上看到印度与西方之间的不同。基林波歇，他在1921年成立了印度的精神分析学会，他曾经写信给弗洛伊德。这接下来是基林波歇信中写道，我的印度病人没有像我欧洲病人那样表现出显著的阉割症状，与欧洲病人相比，想成为女人的欲望更容易在印度的男人病人身上发现。伊底帕斯母亲常常是一个合并双亲的形象，这是一个非常重要的事实。弗洛伊德的回应相当的冷淡，他承诺会去注意波歇所提到的那一些差异，但警告他不要做出任何过早的判断。
Sudhir Kakkar says that in reading early Indian case histories, he was struck by the fluidity of patients' cross-sexual and cross-generational identifications. His own argument is that the hegemonic narrative of Hindu culture, as far as male development is concerned, is neither that of Freud's Oedipus nor of Christianity's Adam. One of the more dominant narratives, says Kakkar, is that of Devi, the great goddess, especially in her manifold expressions of mother in the inner world of the Hindu sun. Further, myths in India are not simply vestiges of infantile fantasies of nations, as for Freud, but vibrantly alive with their symbolic power intact. Kakkar tells a familiar story from Hindu mythology of Skanda, or Subramanian, and Ganesha, sons of Parvati and Shiva, competing to win a fruit offered by their mother as a gift, to whichever of them raced around the universe first. When Skanda triumphantly returned after circumnavigating the universe, he found Ganesha ensconced at his mother's feet, eating the fruit. He had circumambulated his mother, worshipped her, and declared, "You are my universe." Furious, Skanda rushed away to an inaccessible mountaintop to which an annual pilgrimage is conducted to this day.
苏迪卡克说，当他就是印度重要的印度教精神分析师，当他阅读过印度早期的案例的时候，他对当时病人在跨越性别与跨越世代认同上的流动性感到印象深刻。他的理论是，当男性的心理发展上，印度教文化中文化霸权的叙事，并不是弗洛伊德的伊底帕斯，也不是基督教的亚当。 其中支配性比较强的叙事是关于伟大的女神David，特别是她的印度儿子。David的神话在印度儿子内心世界中，作为女性的多种样貌，是在印度男性心里非常重要的一个形象。再者，神话故事并不像欧洲的弗洛伊德认为的那样，是整个民族的婴儿时期幻想的残余。在印度，神话故事是充满活力的，它拥有的象征权力完整无损。卡克尔讲了一个来自印度神话里面为人熟知的故事，是关于赛建陀与象神 Ganesha 他们竞争的故事。 他们是雪山女神帕瓦提跟湿婆神的儿子，他们竞赛谁能先绕宇宙一圈，赢的人呢就可以获得母亲给的水果。当赛建陀围绕了宇宙一圈，得意洋洋的回来时，发现 Ganesha 窝在妈妈的脚边吃着水果，他已经围绕了他妈妈一圈，向他膜拜，而且宣布你就是我的宇宙。 在盛怒之下，赛建陀冲向无人能及的山顶。此后，人们每天都到这个山顶上朝圣，一直到今天。Kakar's
point is that Skanda's punishment is exile from the mother's bountiful presence, and the reward, the promise of functioning as an autonomous adult man. Ganesha remains an infant, and his reward is never to know the pangs of separation from his mother. And Kakar is pointing out that the fact that Ganesha is considered to be the victor in the story, that Ganesha's lot is considered to be superior to Skanda's, is perhaps an indication of the Indian man's cultural preference in the dilemma of separation individuation.
卡克尔的重点是，赛建陀的惩罚是从母亲丰富的存在流放出来，而获得了回馈是成为一个自主的成年男子。 象头神Ganesha，他则依然是个婴孩，他获得的回馈是永远不必去体会跟母亲分离的那种剧痛。至于这个象头神Ganesha，被认为是比赛建陀更为伟大的一个，在故事里面被认为他是比较伟大的，恐怕反映了一个印度男人的文化偏好，表明了在这个分离与成为个体的两难中，印度男人的一个文化偏好。
Thus, even while remaining within the framework of Freudian psychoanalysis, Kakar enables a deconstruction of the universality assumed by psychoanalysis for itself. Freud famously said about Oedipus, "It is the fate of all of us, perhaps, to direct our first sexual impulse towards our mother and our first hatred and our first murderous wish against our father." However, I wonder about the applicability of that confident all of us with our assumed parricidal desire. In Hindu-Indian culture, the living myths with contemporary resonance are about Yayati's son Puru and Shantanu's son Devavrat, both of whom attained to full masculine subjectivity through sacrificing their youth and sexual desire for their fathers. Puru took on an untimely old age that was cursed upon his father, and as a reward, he ascended the throne, though he was the youngest son. It was his lineage that, according to legend, produced King Porus, who valiantly lost to Alexander the Great on the banks of the Jhelum. Devavrata took an oath of lifelong celibacy so that his father's desire for the beautiful Satyavati could be fulfilled, for she would not marry him unless he promised that her son would be king after him. This vow made the god shower flowers upon Devavrata, proclaiming him to be Bhishma, he of the terrible oath, and his father granted him the boon of Swechamrityu, control over his own death. Bhishma went on to become the revered patriarch of the Mahabharata.
即便我们依然在弗洛伊德的精神分析的框架里面，卡卡确实的精神分析所假设的普适性，它透过解构来为让它发生它的作用。弗洛伊德关于伊底帕斯情节的一个名言，接下来是弗洛伊德的话。 或许我们第一次的性冲动是针对母亲而来，而我们第一次的仇恨与仇杀的愿望是针对着父亲，这是我们所有人的命运。我不得不怀疑这个大胆的假设：我们所有人的弑父的欲望的它的适用性，在印度教的印度文化里面，与当代有所共鸣的活的神话是关于殉刑王Yayati的儿子Bulu 与福生王Shantanu的儿子天士，他们两个透过他们的父亲牺牲自己的年少与性欲，来达到全然雄迈的主体性，就是他们透过把自己牺牲给父亲来获得男人的主体性。 布鲁他承接了他父亲身上过早衰老的诅咒，结果登上了王位。尽管他曾经是最小的儿子，依照传说中的普鲁斯国王是他的祖先，他在应有的一个战斗中输给了亚历山大大帝。天使则是发誓他永生不娶，这样他的父亲福生王对美丽的萨瓦提的欲望可以实现。 因为除非福生王发誓他生了儿子，将来可以继承王位，萨瓦提不会嫁给他，所以这个福生王的儿子决定发誓终身不娶，这样他的爸爸可以娶这位美女子。这个誓言呢，使得众神们将花儿撒向天使，宣布他是毕湿摩。他的父亲赐给他得以决定自己死期的恩典。 接着，毗湿摩成为摩诃婆罗达中很受人尊敬的尊长。I
remain with Hindu myths because that is the scholarship that I'm familiar with, and indeed, the opening up of other kinds of cultural resources to such readings can only further dismantle the universalist claims of psychoanalysis. In feminist readings of Hindu myths, we come across the disruption of the gendered self itself, as well as the disruption of the mother. Wendy Doniger has discussed the fact that Hindu deities are serially transsexual and that this is an attempt to recover possibly a lost possibility to express an ambiguity that is present from the start.
我仍然着重的是关于印度的神话，因为这个主题的著作是我所熟悉的，而确实将其他种类的文化资源发掘出来进行这种阅读，将更进一步的拆解精神分析的普世性的宣称。当我们进入女性主义者关于印度神话的阅读，我们发现性别化的自我本身的瓦解，以及大写母亲的瓦解。 Wendy Doniger 的著作里面提到了一个事实：印度的神只是连续的跨越性欲，就是跨越连续跨性者。这是企图要恢复已失去的可能性，去表达从一开始就已经存在的一种性欲上的暧昧性。The
legendary contemporary dancer Chandralekha is said to have answered a question in a public interview in New York. About whether she regretted not having had children by flamboyantly outlining her breasts in the classical Bharatanatyam style and declaring, "My dear, we worship the goddess as Apita Kuchambal, she whose breasts have never suckled." That is, she was referring to the goddess as non-mother.
当代传奇性的舞蹈家 Chandralekha 他在纽约的一个公开访谈中，以这样的方式回答了访谈者问他的问题，问他是不是后悔不曾有过孩子。他以传统的 Bharatanatyam的风格，就用一种传统的风格来描述他自己的乳房，主张他说：“亲爱的，我们膜拜着这样阿佩塔库恰巴阿佩。” Apetakuchaba 这样的女神，她的乳房从来没有拿来喂奶过。那也就是说，她是一个女神，但是她不是一个母亲。
Through the figure of female deities powerful in folk and urban cultures till this day, from the dim past of prehistory, Chandralekha has insisted on the disruption of the fertility-maternity dyad. For her, the fecundity principle is a mysterious force over time being sought to be domesticated into the figure of the mother goddess.
透过在民间文化与都市文化中那些从远古到今日依然相当强而有力的女性神祇的形象， Chandralekha 坚持瓦解将生育力与母亲绑在一起的这一组关系。对她而言，生育的准则是神秘的力量，她随着时间被驯化成了母亲女神这样的形象。
Chandralekha demands, I quote her,On what basis do you call them mothers, these dynamic figures of fierce power who look so calm and confident on the bull, lion, tiger, who wear weapons as ornaments in their hair, who are not at all maternal? Unquote.
她诉求着，究竟凭什么你们要叫这些女神母亲？这些女神她们代表的是暴烈力量的形象。他们骑在公牛身上、老虎身上、狮子身上，看起来是多么的冷静自信。当他们将身上穿着武器，就像在头发上别着小饰品，他们可不代表任何一点母性的价值。
Psychoanalysis then, in conclusion, in non-Western cultures, but there too, as Deleuze and Guattari attest, is an ongoing translation of the self into proper subjectivity.Defined in terms set by norms assumed to be universal. Thus, Freud, in responding to Bose, acknowledges the difference in Indian patients from what he assumes to be the human norm, but advocates the need not to reach hasty conclusions on the basis of Indian experiences, while it seems to me that Bose could legitimately have asked Freud not to reach hasty conclusions on the basis of his own limited experiences of European patients.
于是在非西方的文化中，精神分析是一个进行中的翻译的计划，它将自我翻译成一个恰当的主体性，透过的是一组普世的规范，透过是一组假设性具有普世性的规范来定义主体。这就像德勒兹跟瓜塔里所证实的，其实这样的情形也不只发生在西方，东方，在西方也是相似的。从而弗洛伊德在给波歇的回应里面，他认可了印度病人身上发现了他所假设的人类标准有所出入的差异性，但他却主张不要因为印度的经验而做出太过匆促的结论。这是弗洛伊德当初给波歇的回信。而在我看来，波歇反过来大可去要求弗洛伊德不要依照欧洲病人的有限经验而得出种种太过仓促的结论。谢谢。
Thank you.